to read her bio, but I think you'll really enjoy speaking with her. She's got quite the sense of humor and wit, but it's really dry. So you want to pay attention. Her name is Sybil Tocal. She's the VP of Communications for the Chattanooga Chamber of Commerce. And I have to say, from when I first moved to Chattanooga about 21 years ago, a lot has happened in our city and in our region. And much of that was driven by the role and the things that the Chattanooga Chamber does in the community. And so I was anxious for you to learn about chambers and what they do, so that when you end up living in a community and you're working full time, you'll understand the role of a chamber and why it's important for all of us to be involved in community and environmental development. Prior to Sybil starting, I have invited one of our classmates here, Mark Gindy, to tell you a little bit about a YouTube channel that he started. And I learned about it because he wrote about it in his essay. And I thought it was such a great story that I wanted you to hear that. So he's been given between 2 and 3 minutes to just share his story. He may take 30 seconds, I don't know. But he's got up to 3 minutes to share his story, and Ms. Tocal was aware of that. So he's gonna share a little bit of his story with you, and then we'll transition right over to Mrs. Tocal. So you also wanna pay great attention, because she's gonna tell you something about future jobs that are open for you guys. So let's go ahead and give Ms. Tocal a round of applause and welcome her.
Some of you may know me, and some of you may think you know me. Some of you may think I'm this guy. That is not me. That's my brother. I'm actually this guy. It's another picture. So I, as you can see, have lost a little bit of weight, about 140 pounds now. I was within getting into this fitness journey, I was always nervous. I was nervous of failure. I was afraid of being vulnerable, of putting myself out there, you know, going to the gym and kind of feeling like I'm like on display a little bit. But I ended up overcoming my fears, and I succeeded in losing a bunch of weight. And then a lot of people were convincing me that I should, you know, start a YouTube channel, you know, give advice, food that I was eating, steps that I took, stuff like that, so I could help other people who would also like to lose weight. And I would make excuses again, you know, I don't have a camera, I can't do it, I don't have the right equipment. But I ended up overcoming those fears as well, and I stopped making excuses. I just used my phone camera and recorded, and the sound quality was terrible and the editing was subpar, but I put something out there and I started with that, and I only have, you know, a couple of videos out there, but I plan to continue with this, and it's something that I'm really passionate about. So if you guys want to go ahead and follow me, the YouTube channel is Gindy Fit. So if you guys want to go ahead and do that, YouTube, the Instagrams, the Twitters, it's all there. Thank you.
Can hear me?
Too loud? Yes.
Okay. I've been told I was soft-spoken. So I appreciate the microphone. I am so excited to be here. I love school. I know that makes me a bit of a nerd, but I love it so much that I went back to school in 2012. So I left a full-time job, and you know, I met this awesome guy, and my second husband. And he said, well, what do you really want to do when you grow up? And I was like, well, you know, I don't really want to work at this architecture firm anymore. I really want to go get my master's degree, because I've always wanted to do that. doesn't make a lot of economic sense, but that's what I wanted to do. So he found a job in Atlanta, which is where we found the school I was going to go to. And we sold a bunch of stuff and downsized to a 750 square foot condo in downtown Atlanta. And I went back to school and got my master's in 2014. So that's what brings me here today. Because after that, I need to get a job to pay off all the student loans, right? Does anybody identify with that? So we were looking everywhere. We were like, where are we going to live? We can live anywhere. My child was grown. He's 26. Didn't have to stay in Nashville where we had been before. Didn't really want to stay in Atlanta. It was pretty crowded. And we were looking in Denver. We were looking in Florida. A lot of places in Florida. Denver's pretty expensive. But there's mountains, so you can see the mountains of the water, whole thing going there. So we kept coming back to Chattanooga because my son had stayed in Nashville during that time period, and we were in Atlanta, and Chattanooga just seemed to be the middle point. And we came back, and it had changed a lot since I took him to the aquarium when he was a little kid. You know, has anybody been like to the crash pad or the south side of Chattanooga? Does anybody sound familiar? I got one or two hands. So there's some new architecture that was going on back there, and it was pretty urban looking for Chattanooga, and it looked like maybe there was some growth and development there. So we started also looking in Chattanooga. So this job became available at the Chamber, but I was already kind of sold on Chattanooga as a possibility in our top three. And we did try to go do something in Florida, but that's a different presentation. It's a book and it's not written yet. So we'll talk about that sometime. That's a lot of fun to find out what we discovered about buying a business in the middle of Key West. But for today, we're very happy that we landed in Chattanooga. We were surprised by the architecture. We were surprised by the bikeability of Chattanooga and how beautiful it had gotten. So we're in our fourth year, and I really love it, especially the people and all the volunteers. So that's how we got here. I'm happy to be here. Now I'm going to give you a little bit of an overview, if you will, of what a Chamber of Commerce is. Probably all of you know what a Chamber of Commerce is, but I talked recently to a reporter and he kind of got the word commerce in front of the word chamber, and I wasn't really sure that he knew what he was talking about. I think he thought it was the name of a business, and that was, you know, a little bit disheartening. So I went back and did a little bit of research, and not on Wikipedia. I went to the Association of Chamber of Commerce Executives, and this is part of their definition of a Chamber of Commerce. It's an organization of business members who work together to advance their collective interests while advancing their community. So it could be your community, which is Chattanooga and the greater region. It could be the state or a country. Any of those things can have a Chamber of Commerce. And we can make this a little interactive. We've got time. How many chambers do you think there are in the world? Any guesses? Lots is not a guess. Somebody throw a number out.
4,070.
Wow.
A million.
Not a million. Somewhere in between. 13,000 for the whole for the entire world. There's a place where they register. And so how many do you think there are in the United States? But let me give you a definition. How many do you think there are with a paid staff person just in the United States?
10,000.
It says 3,000. I feel like there's more than that. I feel like they need to update their page. But so we run our chamber with fewer than 40 employees, and we have different parts of it. And we are a member of the Association of Chamber of Commerce Executives, as well as the Tennessee Chamber, which is a statewide chamber. We're also a member of the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. And ACCE, that I was talking about a little earlier, and I'll talk about some more, has been around since 1914, but the Chattanooga Chamber was chartered in December of 1887. So we're 131 years old in December. That's a lot of birthday candles on the cake. We might burn down the block if we're not careful. So we like to say we're 130 years young. And I tell you about those organizations and the business model of the chamber because there are a lot of organizations out there that do business networking, but how many of them make it for more than a century? So that's why we feel like we're the premier business networking organization and also the premier economic development organization. And obviously you have plenty of time to read the mission statement. And we try pretty hard to stick to that. Mission statement gives us a way to make sure that volunteers don't get us too distracted on something we shouldn't be working on. You know, volunteers are great, but sometimes they have ideas that don't fit the mission statement, so you have to deal with that. So I want to talk a little bit about our organization, because I created the slide, marketing's at the top. See, I slid that in there. So administration was at the top. So in the center, you have the leadership, and you have HR and finance, very important core part of our business. And then down one side, you have the councils, membership, events, and events. So they operate as a group. We have 1,700 members. We have 12 councils. We have over 200 events a year. And tons of volunteer hours go into making those a success. We have the incubator on the other side, which I'm going to talk about a little bit more at length. And you have economic development, talent development, which we're going to talk quite a bit about. Leadership Chattanooga, we're going to talk a little bit about. And public policy, which is basically working with your elected officials to make sure that business interests are represented at the state and local levels. We don't really deal too much with the federal, but we did have Senator Bob Corker come in and talk to us on Friday, and that was a lot of fun. He had some great questions, and we had a lot of member activity in that. They had a lot of questions, too. So then if you switch over and look at the volunteers and how they're organized, they all report up essentially to the Chamber Board of Directors. You've got 12 councils, and I'll talk a little bit about them, but not too much. And then you've got the other things there, what interest groups, diversity, inclusion. We're going to talk a little bit about just about everything up there. Can you read it? The Fonties one? Oh, good. Okay. So I love economic development. Do people recognize someone there?
Yeah.
What? Really? Did everybody meet him? Everybody knows him? Awesome. Okay, well, we're going to play a video with him in a little bit later. And that video relates directly to talent recruitment, which is part of what we do there in economic development. And then we do a lot of work with the media. So Charles Wood is our Vice President of Economic Development. And he likes rankings because they get the attention of site consultants. And site consultants decide where they're going to put businesses, headquarters or manufacturing. And so he's always like setting the goal pretty high for us to get in the rankings. The ones we picked out for this were the top 25 for growth. And then we were also voted Best Outdoor City in Outdoor Magazine 2 times. And you can only go up for that every 5 years. So we made it, I think we were in a competition with somebody out in Washington State. They were friendly about it. And population size does matter. So I'll just tell you a secret. I know that it's going to be recorded, but I'm going to tell you this anyway. So we have two mayors. We have Hamilton County Mayor Coppinger, and we have City Mayor Andy Burke. And they each like to talk about the population of the county for Mayor Coppinger. And then Mayor Burke likes to talk about the, can you hear me about this? But you need it for video, right? Okay. We'll just pause. Okay, we're telling a secret anyway, so you can take that off the video. So Mayor Burke likes to talk about the city size. Well, none of those add up to 1 million people, and that's what people are looking for if they're a site consultant. There's just a whole lot of companies that are not even going to consider you unless you're at 1 million people. You can look at the labor workforce around Nashville and Davidson County and see what they've done there. So if the official Census Bureau MSA, which is Metropolitan Statistical Area, is a little bit over 500,000. The city, you can see that there, in the county. And so I'm struggling with that. In fact, one of our projects today is get the Wikipedia page updated. So if you want to do a project on the side. So are we good? Do you want me to pause or keep going? Keep going. Keep going. So we developed the Greater Chattanooga Economic Partnership, which is 16 counties. I love this picture. So. Sometime I'll tell you what the t-shirt says. So we pulled this together, and Charles Wood is in charge of that. And so we're in our third year. So when I got into the chamber, we had one website. Now we have three. One is the Greater Chattanooga Economic Partnership, and the site consultants can go straight to that and pull a report for anything they want in terms of demographics, labor pool, access to transportation. And I would encourage y'all to go to the site and check it out. It's pretty robust, and if you're going to be looking for a job, it's a very good place for you to get information about all the companies that are here, and I hope you stay here. I may ask you that 3 or 4 times. I hope you stay in our region, because we need talent. So there you go, $32 billion economy. We don't think of it that way, do we? It's a lot. And then Hamilton County, we're the largest employment sectors.
what's really fascinating is the work and how it develops over time. So instead of looking at this in four-year periods, which is how the city and county tend to look at their budgets and how we look at our own capital campaign, if you look at a six-year span, we did just a little bit under 350 new projects for the entire region, 27,000 new jobs, and $8 billion dollars in new investments. So would it have come here without the chamber? I don't think so. But I don't think it would have come here without all 16 counties working together. So that has been a really good, exciting thing to have happen. One of the most exciting and first notable successes will be the Nokian tire manufacturer. Has anybody heard of Nokian yet? No? They are locating in Dayton in Wray County, and they're bringing 500 jobs. So they're snow tires. And I'll tell you, this is kind of funny. So Charles Wood, who I've mentioned already, their economic development team a lot of times doesn't know who they're presenting to. Like, they always have code names. They won't tell you that they're Amazon or Snow Tire Company or whatever back office firm that is coming in here, or a bank. They won't tell you the name. The site consultant is usually representing the company. So he was driving them around on either the first or second visit, and he was bragging about the weather, and he said, yeah, hardly ever snows here. And then he backed up as a snow tire company, so he's like, well, occasionally it snows. We have places in the mud you can play. This was interesting. We just pulled these slides together for a different presentation, but I bet you didn't know that there are $7 billion in foreign direct investment since 2008. You can see all the firms up there. But obviously, you probably heard about Bacher and VW, right? Yes? Little Debbie had an expansion. That's also, that's not foreign investment, but it's one of the things that helps the area grow. And that'll show you that we are have a greater percentage of foreign-owned entities than the U.S. is on average going up. And if you can read that one, it's 22 countries that are represented in Tennessee, and that is growing a lot. So I've been mentioning this regional approach with the 16 counties. Some people in the company that I might have mentioned already I've been talking about how Nashville started doing regional development in 2010. It was more like 1990, because I was working at SunTrust Bank when they started doing that. And they pulled together the eight donut counties around Nashville. And that's how they got the Nissan headquarters, Bridgestone headquarters, and a number of other ones, and pretty much doubled their population in the last 10 or 15 years, probably. So I lived there for 20 years. But lots of areas are understanding that you have to recruit regionally. You can't, like, be in competition with your county right next door. That doesn't work. Now, yes, would we like to get a headquarters rather than Nashville? Yes, but when it comes to the state, we all pretty much work together, first of all, to get it to Tennessee, and then it breaks down from there. The incubator that I mentioned earlier, it's not like a regular thing. Chambers are all kind of put together for whatever their community needs. And our incubator has been around. First of all, do y'all know what an incubator is? A business incubator? Everybody's going, duh, okay.
No.
All right.
I don't know what it is.
What?
I don't know what it is. Could you tell
me? So it's a place where you bring businesses together, and then either some government and some nonprofit work, like the Chamber's nonprofit, and we work with Hamilton County, and we allow businesses to use the space in the building for a little bit less than they would pay on the market. In the marketplace. In addition to that, they get additional services. Like, they might get accounting services. They get, in our particular case, we have the Tennessee Small Business Development Corporation is inside there, which is a state-run program that helps you learn about all kinds of things related to running your business properly. And we also do, before we let anybody in the incubator, they have to have a business plan. They have to know what they're doing. They have to reach a certain level of sales before they can come in, because we want to ensure that they're serious about this and that they are really going to go forward. So ours has been around for 30 years, young, and we've graduated 565 companies.
Wow.
We run it with the Hamilton County government. That's part of their contribution to our bottom line in terms of what we develop in the county. I'm pretty proud of this staff. 45% are minority-owned or women-owned. We like to work with better-known businesses as well. We do programs with them. And then the incubator did a study about over a 12-month period, wasn't like exactly precise with the calendar. And they brought in $17 million in a 12-month period, and $13 million of that was new money to Hamilton County. In other words, they're bringing dollars in. Charles Wood likes to talk about bringing dollars in, not recycling dollars. So if you get your paycheck and you go to the dentist and the ice cream place or the opposite way around, you're just recycling your paycheck. You're not bringing like a new dollar in. Does that make sense? So this is my one of my favorites, new favorite success stories. Do people know?
Yes.
You do? Awesome. Has she talked to you?
Our analyst team worked with her on her project.
Okay. The short version of the story is their two-year-old almost died in front of her, and she knew CPR. But she just, you forget when you panic. And so she's developed a product that has all the instructions for CPR and lays over the body, and anybody can give CPR whether they've been trained or not, and it's called LifeWrap. And she's talking to some very big national companies. It's pretty impressive.
She actually hired the active student who had been working with her. So it's Felicia Jackson, and
well, I'm so excited about that. So yeah, so I love it when we bring reporters in when you go over to the incubator. The other success story up there, RMJ Tactical developed tomahawks. What are those things that you cut things with and can break out of a car? Anyway, they developed those, but for like special forces like the Navy SEALs. And they moved out with their own, the very niche product. And the branch technology basically 3D prints houses. So that one's pretty spectacular, and I can talk about branch technology all day. They were my favorite until, of course, became my favorite because branch moved out. They're not my favorite anymore. They've grown. They've graduated. So there's a lot of resources there that I mentioned. That's why the incubator helps people become successful. Talent development. So we did some research. I love market research. And I finally got somebody to let me do some. So we're a nonprofit, so we actually had an advertising agency donate their services, which is how I got to do it, because they were going to invest at a certain level. And we pulled together five different small business groups and asked them open-ended questions about the chamber, what they knew about what we did, et cetera. And all across the board, whether they were large banks or whether they were small retail companies, they all said that talent development, and that's you, is their number one priority. They cannot get enough qualified, talented, skilled people. They just need more. So they want to see the chamber work harder at that. One of the ways we've done that is through Chattanooga 2.0. Has anybody heard of Chattanooga 2.0? No? Yes? Well, I would encourage you to look up their website. This is a program that started 2 or 3 years ago, right after I got here. And it's an initiative to try to increase the number of students who graduate from Hamilton County High Schools, but it also has like 9 other priorities, starting with K-12 and actually starting with preschool. So they're breaking a lot of really good ground in terms of trying to help. But that's not going to fix the problem immediately. We have to be importing talent, and we have to be training them and doing a better job of it. So we had a workforce development team, and you see them there. And they've been doing that work. Now we're going to talk talent development because that's the newest, coolest word. Our new CEO is Christy Gilmore. She's on part of a national group that's working on talent development. That's her project. She's in a leadership group that's being funded by a foundation, not our investors, which is awesome. So she went out to LA and did a lot of study work on this. But prior to Christy, we've had this team in place, Darian Scott, a student, and Kathy Humble, and then on the far right, Maddie Moran. Maddie will celebrate her 50th work anniversary in June. She's been doing talent development work since the 2000s, basically. And she has helped over 205,000 Hamilton County students. So we're definitely making a national story out of that. We got her in Black Enterprise magazine, and we're working on some other things. But she does a survey after they get through with the programs, and the figure I like the best on this particular slide, this data I like the best, is that 61% of the students decided to do something different. They decided to aim higher, or they decided to get more education. And that's pretty impressive. One of the programs that we do is called Reality Check, and they go into a big room where there's little booths, and there's the bank, and there's the car place, and there's everywhere you have to spend money on from your paycheck. And they get given an assignment with, here's how much money you need to spend, because you're either like a medical technician or a librarian, and you're either single or you have kids, and you're married, and your spouse either works or they don't work, and they have to make their budget work, and then they get to the end, they might have some money left over, and the counselors will say, well, you need to go put some money in 401k, and they're like, well, what's that? What's retirement? What do I have to save now for retirement? So you kind of see a lot of light bulbs go off that day, and that's what really charges Maddie, I think, gets her excited about it. I volunteered in January. It was pretty fun. They were so endearing. So Leadership Chattanooga is another one of those programs that we do. Professional development, you can count on for the rest of your life. If somebody hasn't told you that here, I'm reinforcing it. I went through Leadership Chattanooga in 2016. It's a program that gets people like me and you out in the community and teaches them about aspects of the community that they might not understand. We spent our first day, for our first day, you go catch a bus to get to your first meeting place. And the point is to give you another vantage point of how people get to work or get to their classes or get to their daycare if they do not have a car. So it just teaches you all about how Chattanooga really works in places where you might not engage in, especially, you know, or doing something where you're not going to encounter social services. I talked about the member survey. We do a public policy survey. Public policy is huge, really important way for our members to interact with the elected officials and make sure that business interests are heard. So, an amazing amount of volunteer work goes into this, 7,100 volunteer hours a year. This is from our last annual report. I already told you 200 events, and we already talked about the councils. The councils are really pretty impressive. They're like a powerhouse for us. So this is a national publication called Chamber Executive, and it's from the ACC group that I mentioned earlier. And we're there on the cover. We were written up because of the geographic councils. So these are like spread out all over Hamilton County. We've got Midtown and Downtown and Mootawa Collegedale and Brainerd and North Chattanooga and North Hamilton. And they will meet once a month and have a speaker. So any given month, there are 12 different programs going on all over the city or the county. Young professionals of Chattanooga, if you stay, I would encourage you to get involved in that. That's a really good way to network. They also have a protege program. So the one council I want to talk about was the International Business Council. It meets every other month. And if you don't have a class that day, I'd really encourage you to go hear some of the speakers. Interestingly enough, 75 languages are spoken in Hamilton County High Schools. They know this because they interview the students every year on the first day of school and ask them the primary language at home. So we may look like we're not very diverse sometimes in Chattanooga, but we really are. We always need to do a better job of telling everyone's story. And that's what we do in marketing communications, is tell a pretty story. So we did win Chamber of the Year. self-promotion, but that's a big deal out of those 3,000 chambers. And it included Canada and the islands. So that was pretty fun. That was July last year. And there is a really crazy video online if you want to look at it. We scream like children. It's just, I thought Charleston was going to win. I was screaming because I was happy I didn't have to fill out the application again. It's like that. It's like, we don't have to do this again for 5 years. But seriously, I think Cheryl Millsaps, who runs our HR department in finance, you should remember her name if you want to work with the chamber. She's been working really hard for a long time to get us that fifth star. So accreditation from your peers, and it's a really rigorous process. Less than 2% of all chambers in the country have 5 stars. So we were able to do that, and I think she's just as proud, if not prouder, of that than the Chamber of the Year. So one of my favorite parts of my job is, I don't want to pick out just one part, but one of my favorite parts is bragging about Chattanooga outside of Chattanooga. We do not have an Associated Press Bureau here. Does everybody know what Associated Press does? Yes, no? It's a wire service agency that tells news. A lot of times they'll pick it up out of the local papers. We don't have an AP Bureau anymore here. Knoxville doesn't have one. We don't have a weekly business journal. We have the Times Free Press, and they do a monthly magazine that we participate in. But this means that if we're not out there actively telling our story, it's not going to get told, because there's not enough writers here writing about us. So we engaged with this young editor for Climbing Magazine. We were the cover story. She's actually loved it so much she's moving here in December. So that's pretty good. This is just more about cities with the lowest our own costs. Sometimes I don't even know we're going after these rankings until we find out we're in them. Then easy, affordable. Curb Magazine said we were a very affordable place to live. This was fun. The Financial Times, Sam Fleming called me kind of out of the blue. We weren't even really pitching him hard. And he wanted to come and talk about manufacturing because that's what was being talked about at the national level. I wanted him to talk about our airport investment with a company called Westar Aviation, but he wanted to talk about French technology. So that's the picture that went in there, is the robot. And that's the robot that produces one of five now that produce all those 3D printed items. And I was talking about earlier, you know, sometimes our president makes their minds. Yes, every day. So he was making some headlines, and we were wanting to talk about foreign companies actually creating jobs here. And I showed you those slides earlier about foreign direct investment. I love this one because it says that Chattanooga is charming, so that's fun. And I already told you we're the best town ever twice. This was really great. We got a Mozilla grant just recently, and I put the Enterprise Center up there because it's one of the nonprofits that works on getting us more innovation grants. And this one is cool because it helps students in one part of the country use a microscope that's like 4,000 something. It's fabulous, and I have those on. It's wonderful. And so that was a really big deal because it's free money. And this one is more about it. I just wanted to show you a picture of a young lady using the virtual reality. So we measure just about everything that we can measure, including media impressions, and we're in the billions. Our media impressions, if you look at that chart, the bar on the far right, on my right, your right team, is not a complete year. So that's only to date. And our fiscal year runs from July 1st to June 30th. So we're not quite there yet. And we just finished up a media tour in New York City. So a couple of us went to New York and we met with Bloomberg and we met with Business Insider. We met with the Wall Street Journal. We met with VentureBeat. We met with a couple of other ones. Oh, we were on the New York Stock Exchange floor. Does anybody watch Cheddar? It's a live broadcast from the New York Stock Exchange. Look it up. Mayor Burke was on there. He said something funny, shocked the anchor. So when I got there, we had Trend Magazine, a business Trend Magazine, that came out four times a year, and it was still in print. We are still in print because we're in the back part of the Edge magazine that I was talking about. We developed a partnership with the Times Free Press. But we're also online. So ChattanoogaTrend.com is a great place for you to find stories about all those companies you want to go work for. And here's another, that's what it looks like online. We started that November of 2014. Anyway, it's been around like a little bit over 3 years. So we went from zero readers to about 5,000 readers a month. And then we just implemented a new part of this where we're pushing headlines out. So you can sign up for the headlines, and once a week on Thursday, it'll tell you the top three stories. And that's actually automated. So that's really getting a lot more viewers to our websites. It's been pretty fun. Made Amanda Ellis happy. You want to remember Amanda Ellis's name. So we just talked to her. All right, so I really encourage you to look at this video of us all screaming in Nashville. It's pretty funny and it's very heartwarming. And then here's another video about Reality Check. We went to video and really pushing it when Facebook was making it go up higher in the algorithm. Of course, we all know what's going on with Facebook, and I'm not an expert, but I'm watching diligently to see what Mark Zuckerberg's going to say and how it's going to impact us. But we don't ever sit still, so we're developing six podcasts. I'm calling them a pilot, and we'll be putting those out there in the next couple of months. We want to record all six of them before we put it out there. Our library downtown has an amazing sound studio. It's a lot of fun to use, and we're really super excited about it. So if you've got a story that you want to pitch the podcast, you know, be thinking about how you would do that and who you would want on there. And, of course, we have public cost. We're going to hire somebody to do that. We've been doing a lot of it on our own, but the person who was doing it left. So that's the Leadership Chattanooga class on the footsteps of the Capitol. It's a lot of work that we don't really brag about a lot, but it means a lot to our members. So we've covered mysteries. I work with Maria Noble. Does anybody here know Maria? sessions. It would be awesome. She's director of diversity and inclusion. And I'd like to talk about this as, it's two things. It's a philosophy that needs to go across everything that we do, and we do. And then it's also a lot of programs that she lines up to help connect really large suppliers with minority-owned, women-owned, and veteran-owned businesses. There's a lot of certifications that go with that. The paperwork can be daunting. And she had somebody tell her the other day that the best thing that she did for them was that she was able to give them the confidence to get the paperwork done, to get the certification, to go talk to one of the larger suppliers. She has a huge event. I think you're going to be here in the summer in June? Yes, no? Anybody going to be here in June? No, I wasn't. Okay. There's an event called Diversify. We're going to get a really good speaker. And then that'll be on Wednesday. It's a luncheon. It's affordable. And if you want to go, I've got my business card here. If you want to go, I will find you a ticket. So, and then 2 days after that, we will have a marketplace so that diverse businesses can have more foot traffic to the types of things that they're putting out there. It also connects them with a lot of the suppliers. These are some of her other programs. You can read them. She's really dynamic. She's a great speaker. Last year we had Isabel Wilkerson here. So I'm a bit of a book nerd. My MFA is in writing. And if you haven't read her book about the Great Migration, you should read it. It's a fabulous book. The economic impact was tremendous, and she gave a very heartwarming speech that made everybody think about how they treat people. And so her programs, Bree's programs, have brought in $3 million into the community. We're a chamber, we're a business organization, we have to have our goals. So this year they're down to, I think, only six. We're going to maximize membership value and champion our councils, promote public policy, all the things I've already talked about. And foster strategic leadership development in the region. Now, I'm going to pause, take any questions you might have, and put a different presentation up here. It's a case study. We're going to watch a couple of videos if they work. Does anybody have any questions while I play with you?
When you were talking about the diversified thing, we talked about diversity, can you talk about a little bit more what that is going to be about?
It's basically a luncheon that we'll have a convention center. Those seven major events are at the convention center in Chattanooga. And so we'll have like a small business awards. We have Spirit of Innovation awards. And they're money makers for the chamber. They make a little bit of money, but they're really just in order to do more networking and promote certain things. So Spirit of Innovation, I think, is like in the top two of my favorites because we get all these innovative companies in there. Branch Technology has won. There's a bunch of other companies that have won that are really kind of exciting. One of them won and is leaving Chattanooga. Anyway, I'll tell you about that later. But, okay, so Charles, and you've already heard me mention Charles a lot. I like working with Charles. I also work with Sandra Berg, who's in charge of membership. About a year and a half, maybe 2 years ago, Charles came to us and said, we need to recruit more tech startups. So these first videos were talking about getting more tech companies to consider locating here. We don't need all of Silicon Valley, just a couple of Silicon Valley. From Denver or wherever.
Before you start, what companies in Chattanooga are doing hosting?
Hosting?
Yeah, like website, database, you know any of those?
I know DC Blocks put in a huge server. It's a backup server. It's going to be able to buck Netflix to us a lot faster. I would have to research that. You could go to our business directory, which I'll show you where it's at later, and you could put in a particular search phrase and find out of the 1,700 companies.
Okay.
And you can take my business card.
I'll talk to you.
Yeah, anybody that wants at the end can grab my business card and email me. So, okay. So Charles came to us and said, I want a video that's going to recruit tech talent. And we all agreed it should be nothing like a subdivision where all the houses look the same. Have you seen recruitment videos? You could put Austin on there, you could put Greenville on there, you could put wherever. They look like the same city, and we didn't want to do that. So, some of you are giggling. So we needed a really cool character that we could create. Tell me, why is somebody giggling?
Oh, he's working.
Oh, so did you hear him? So Castwell Fighter is our iconic character, and he did used to work here. So, but he answered a casting call, and his name's Castwell. How ironic is that? So we developed this really cute video, which if the stars are aligned, we'll play.
This is good. This is Sadie. Sadie coded the original Kissing Wolfpap mouth type. It uses your phone's built-in pressure sensitivity to rate your funky lip action and connect you with other lonely canoodlers. You'll see what we mean when you kiss the screen. Sadie was located on the West Coast, but kept running into problems. Her six-figure D-list interns couldn't stop breaking screens and getting their tongues electrocuted. Then the local government outlawed public displays of affection, halting research and development. And to top it off, their internet connection was essentially carrier pigeons. She needed an overhaul. You're welcome. So she moved to Chattanooga for a fresh start. A couple of new hires from the local talent pool helped redo the app using something called software. She scored a metric butt-ton of new downloads. Traffic like this would never have been possible until she moved to the Gig City. Now, we're not saying that Chattanooga made everything perfect.
Chattanooga literally made everything perfect.
But Sadie just did.
We didn't just do cute video, we did a whole campaign around it. And part of what also happened later was that companies came to us like bellhops and said, we're having trouble recruiting tech talent. What can you do to bump up the visibility? So this video ties into a website that talks about how cool Chattanooga is. And of course, the literally perfect was meant, you know, ironically, sardonically, you know, tongue in cheek. So we were kind of poking fun of ourselves, and that got some attention. So the website has jobs actually listed on it, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. We did targeted paid placement on social media, which is kind of creepy to talk about in the current environment, but it worked. So there's the website.
Through what forces did you do that?
I'm getting there.
Channels.
I'm getting there. I'm on that. That's next. After the next video, if this one plays. We also promoted it in advance. You know how you can tell somebody you want to know when they're going to post something?
Employees, and I'm here to take them back.
12,000 impressions.
it's not what a normal chamber does with a video. 3,000 interactions, more than 300 shares and comments, so a lot of engagement with it. And we were very targeted with that paid advertising and with organic reach. So we were looking for Southeast Tech folks. We were looking at San Francisco and Denver. Rowers, people who paddle and kayak, the head of the Hooch brings in a ton of money every year. And also, of course, people in the area that were looking, because we didn't want them to leave. So those are the response numbers we got. And have y'all tried targeted advertising on Facebook? Have you gone in and yeah, it's creepy, but it works. they know everything about me. I know that's going to change, but I don't know. So these are all impressive stats. The organic reach actually outweighed or outperformed the paid reach, which Jeremy Henderson, our creative director, says just kind of floored him. He's never really seen that. And then I love that the videos, our interaction with the videos went up, you know, who doesn't love a stat like 4,700%? That's cool. You can tell that story. We got lots of really good comments on Twitter, which made me super happy. One of my favorite lines in there is calling it the Tom Hanks of places. And we do a lot of things that are probably not what most chambers do. Jeremy's really good about thinking about these things. So we tweeted at Tom Hanks, and we tweeted at his wife, Rhea Wilson, and we invited him here for the weekend. It didn't happen, but we did. We thought about it. So we had a lot of fun with that. So that was Twitter. On LinkedIn, we had more than 15,000 impressions, and most importantly, we had direct responses to job openings. And then we had a CEO out of this. She's been quoted in the paper as saying that she came because of the video. She showed the video to her husband, and she wanted to be somewhere cool like that. We like her. Awesome. We hit the front page of advertising Reddit. We did not place that. You can't place things on Reddit for those of you who know about it. We got coverage in local and national media. And these are just two of the early ones, City Lab and Planetizen. Am I saying that right? We won some awards. We won a butt ton load of awards to quote the video, which is awesome, and we're still winning. So for the first year with the Addies, which is the Advertising Federation, we won for the first two videos because we put those in there. Maybe we put one of the two. And then this year, we put Cha-Cha Land in there, and it's gone to the regionals, and we'll win the regional award in a week or two. And then if it goes on to the nationals, we'll get to go to Chicago instead of Mississippi to pick it up. So I told Jeremy he could go to Mississippi and not go to Chicago, right? Because that's only fair, right? So this is probably the most important slide. We have internships. Amanda is the person to call. If you are interested in any writing or graphic design or some combination thereof, internship, you can't call her because I didn't give you the phone number, but you can find that on the website. But that is her email, and she can send you the job description or send you the right spot. And I should send you the phone number. She's awesome. Her presentation was literally perfect. You don't have to do that. Don't force yourself. No, I did do that at ACC. I did it in July, and I did include it. So, I will take questions. What questions have you got? We got, what, 4 more minutes-ish? So, anybody have questions? Yes, sir.
I saw that you posted an email early that as far as marketing and just working to have another person to talk to as far as other
internships or other... Another person to what?
We can talk to as far as other internships or
other... Yes, let me get back with your professor on that because... There's a ton of them, and I'm not an expert on a lot of them. There's not like one place. So many people are offering internships now. You might check out the Trinity 2.0 website. I can push in touch with, we can maybe ask Maddie, Moran, and also Darian Scott. So those are the other numbers that I would write down is Maddie, M-A-T-T-I-E, Moran, and Darian Scott. And all of our emails are on the website because that's where we are, we're a chamber. So you can read your emails on there. Nothing else. Those were all local actors and actresses, original music, original singing, and yes, we paid them because that's important to me.
did you mention something at the beginning about like the airport expansion that was happening?
Yeah, the Chattanooga Airport is expanding.
That's awesome. Mm-hmm. Like adding new gates or what?
What?
Like adding new gates?
I don't know the answer to that, but I can look it up. Terry Hart, if you want to Google Chattanooga Airport, it's Terry Hart. probably find it on the latest news. I don't have those stats memorized. We have a good partnership with the airport. We advertise there, and the Coca-Cola thing that you saw.
Yeah.
We paid for this with a grant, and Coca-Cola was the large participant in that, so we did not use any investor money in this.